Okay, can you hear me? Okay, awesome. I'm going to talk about compact time regular expressions. You probably heard about this topic. My name is Hanna. I work as I'm national Czech National Body Chair for ISO C++ Committee. I'm senior researcher in AVAST, and I'm organizing Prague meetup. Maybe you heard about it. If you don't, Google it. We have nice content on YouTube. If you want to tweet, use the hashtag CTRE and NDC Tech Town. And this is my handle. It will be on the left, on the bottom. Okay, regular expression. How many of you, at least once in their career, use regular expression? Okay. Almost every language has a regular library, not C. Okay, we have regular expression on the top. And if you try to match one big file, doesn't matter for this case. In parallel, it's 300 milliseconds. In EGREP, it's 6.7 seconds. It's a big difference. But try some languages, script languages. Node.js, JavaScript Core, PHP, Python. It's not great. Compiled languages, Java and Rust. So difference. Java is on the right, Rust is on the left. And look at C++. That's standard regular expressions. And I'm going to talk about a library called CTRE, which is here. If you change the regex, you can change the ordering based on the engines. So it's same, but finally, C++ is not the slowest. Anyway, thanks to my friends, which give me the benchmarks code, so I can run different languages I cannot write in them. Okay, standard regular expression. There is an example how to use standard regular expression in C++. We have function extract date, which take string view as a parameter, return optional of date. There is a pattern containing the signature of date, and it extracts year, month, day, at least for me. And in case it doesn't match, it returns null opt. But stat regex can throw, so it cannot be no except. If you provide wrong regular expression in your program, it will crash in runtime, not during compilation. So it cannot be no except. Also, you cannot provide string view as an argument. You need to provide pair of iterators. And because you are providing pair of iterators, you need to change smatch to different type, match result, string view iterator. And each time you call this function, the pattern will be parsed and internal table will be built. So you need to make this static. It's ugly. I'm done with this example. It compiles 1.3 seconds. Just this example, nothing else. Okay, compile time regular expression library I'm talking about. Same example with the library. We have same function, taking string view, returning optional. But argument is a string as a template argument, which is C++ 20 feature. And you can extract with structure binding each capture, year, month, day, easily. If it doesn't match, full match, it will return null opt. And return date in other case. Notice it's no except. Because if you do error in your regular expression, it will give you compile time error. Your regular expression contains error. This is the best I can do currently in C++. But it's better than exception in the runtime. It supports emoji. It supports emoji in compile time. So you can static assert if string is emoji only or not. Thanks to, it's not fully merged, it's a different branch. And thanks to Corentin Jabal, to providing a Unicode table for me, which I can integrate into the library. Okay, also the library supports DFA matching and searching with function fast search, fast match. And I'm going to talk about DFA matching in this talk only. It behaves same, but it doesn't support capturing because DFA regular expressions cannot support captures. But sometimes you don't need them. And that's not more. Features are PCRE to compatible dialect. It's not exactly the same, but it's enough. It's basic support Unicode, it's constexpr. You cannot provide a pattern during runtime. And is there someone who needs pattern provided in runtime? Anyone? Raise your hand. Okay, seems we don't need it. If you, okay, one. So you can use some library, external, but not standard library because it's slow. The pattern is built during compilation, which costs you something on your compilation time, but it gives you performance. But you can do constexpr and runtime matching. So, but constexpr matching is actually useless if you don't want to check your input in some sort of unit test during compilation. It gives you quick regular expression matching and searching. It supports structure binding and DFA without captures and generates nice assembly I will show you later. Technical details, it's small header-only library, only 8,000 lines. It supports all major compilers, Clang, GCC, MSVC. Just today I got back about something in MSVC, so it's open source, Apache 2.0 license, I think still correct, and it's on GitHub, or you can look on compiletime.re, and there is a link. Okay, regular expressions. Regular expression formally is empty set of input, which doesn't accept anything, empty string, which can be accept, one literal char, concatenation of multiple regular expressions, alternation of multiple regular expression, and repetition of multiple regular expression. There are some non-formal syntax constructs like optional, which can be modified into epsilon or something. Plus separation, which is A concatenated with A star. And back reference is not part of formal regular expressions, which makes the language much more stronger. And I'm not supporting them in DFA matching, obviously. Okay, if you see regular expression as you are used to, it can be always converted into formal pattern. This is exactly the same. Yeah. And the pattern is actually some sort of the tree, like abstract syntax tree of the pattern. So it's something or something, concatenated with something, and so on. But how, in my library, I need to parse the pattern somehow, build the AST somehow, and somehow store it. How do you store something which you don't know how it will be big in compile time? It's tree-like structure. You can allocate in 20, but only EDG implements allocation in constexpr. Or you can use type-based expressions, like expression templates, or tuple-like empty types. I went with tuple-like empty types. In this case, we have atoms for describing the AST. We have, we have epsilon, we have char, we have concatenation, we have alternation, we have star, and we have optional, and we have plus, like this. Notice these types are empty. It's just type, nothing else. For this regular expression pattern, CT in, it's not capture, it's just run braces, RE that type looks like this: concatenation, optional concatenation, and two chars. We change it to something different. We can do A or B. And just parse the pattern and generate the type. Okay, but how do you convert the pattern into AST in compile time? You need to write parser. In my case, I used LL1 parser, and I'm using it to convert pattern into a type. I provided PCRE compatible grammar, which I designed for the parser, and output type is the AST with atoms I showed you. Okay, how does LL parser works? How many of you write or in their career LL1 parser? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, 6. Oh, few hands. It's a formal construct which start symbol on stack. That is a stack, and there is a start symbol. In each iteration of the automaton, it pops one symbol from the stack, look on the table based on current char on the input, and decides what to do. It decides to push some string of symbols on the stack, pop char from the input, move to the next one, or reject input. At the end, when there is empty stack and empty input, it accepts. This is grammar for the really simple regular expression, not the one in a library, but you can see how it looks like. It's grammar is actually a function of symbol to char, symbol and char into something. On the top, you can see symbols on the input. On the left, you can see symbols on the top of the stack. And based on that, automaton can decide if it's going to push something on the stack, push nothing on the stack, which is like move to next step, but removing one symbol from the stack, pop input, reject, or accept at the end. There is a special symbol on the right, which is epsilon, which means empty input, and Z0, which means empty stack on the left bottom. There is an example how the LL parser is working. For example, we have the regular expression A or B. So at the end, at the start, we have start symbol S. Start symbol S, and symbol A on the input. There is a special terminal or other which push something on the stack, because if there is anything else, it push the other mode sequence alternation. Then we see there is symbol A and other, we pop it. Now there is epsilon, so we just move forward, epsilon move forward. There is alternation, so we push alternation and do the parsing. At the end, it will accept. If I change the pattern somehow, there will be missing closing parent. It will parse, eat first closing parents, and go to end, and there is missing parents, so it rejects. So the grammar describes the regular expression pattern formally. Okay, but how can you represent the symbols in C++ for the grammar? Use again, empty struct. And you need to mark some struct or type as a start symbol, which will be used at the beginning of the algorithm. And another thing is we need to describe the table somehow for the template data programming technique. So we need to use some dispatching. So if we have symbol and char on input, we need to push something. There is a function which takes symbol and term, and it gives it a list of types which I'm going to return. And if it's symbol, they are same, I'm popping input. If it's symbol and char, which means anything else I didn't specify. I use dot dot dot, which has the lowest priority for template overload for function overloading, which means reject. And at the end, if there is a special symbol for empty stack and epsilon, it accepts. This function doesn't need any, they have only definition, I always mix them up, but no declaration. There is no body for this function. It's just signature, and that's all I need for this technique. Okay, we need to take the grammar and pass it to compiler, to a parser. So we just wrap it into another struct. It's like namespace, but it's closed, and we can use it as an argument in template. The parser is used like this. We have parser, which takes first argument, the grammar. Second argument is the input we are matching, and there is a variable called correct, which contains true or false if it's accepting or not. Parser looks like this. First argument is grammar, which take grammar, function f, take something on the top of the stack somehow, and current term, and based on that, it returns some type, and I know what I should do, because everything is template and instantiated, and so on and so on. But you need to provide string in during compilation somehow, which is in C++ 20, you can use it with class non-type template parameters, which was introduced by Jeff Snyder and Louis Dion in paper, and it's part of C++ 20. And with some class template deduction arguments and stuff, that you can have fixed string as a template argument. I'm not going into details, you can read the paper. P732. Yeah, there is a some constructor and some deduction. Anyway, we need also implement this stack I'm using for LL parser. So I need some type to hold the types, because everything is type during template metaprogramming. There is a list which contains something on stack. There is a function push which take current stack and number of arguments, and it just push it on the stack. So it's functional programming. You're not modifying the stack, you are returning new stack. So you take stack, something, and return new stack. If you are popping something, you just look at, on the symbols on the stack, look on the first symbol, and then return stack without first symbol. Same for top. You need to look on the top of your stack, but you are returning the top type. And also you need to check if your stack is empty. So if you are looking on the top symbol of your stack and it's empty, you are returning special symbol, which means empty stack. Okay, how does it fit together? The parser looks like this. First, two arguments. There is the variable correct, which called function parse, which start with stack with start symbol. There is a function getChar, which look on the current position of input, and which is template argument, because I'm returning different types in this case, term or epsilon. And if I'm in boundaries of the input, I'm returning term. Otherwise, I'm returning epsilon. Because I can, because it's template argument, so I can return different type based on the argument. I cannot do it with normal runtime arguments, so that's the reason why people want context per arguments. Okay, parse function have two arguments. Position, current position, and stack, which is provided as the runtime argument, but it's deduced, because it's just a type. It look on the top of the stack. It look on current terminal or epsilon. It called function f from the grammar. And they could type the return type and instantiate it. So the function doesn't need definition. And pop one input from the stack and call function move. And my function move decides based on the function overloading if I'm pushing something, which is list push something. So I call function push and call function parse again. If it's popping input, I just move input next to next char and use same stack and recursively call myself because it's functional programming. If I got a reject symbol from the grammar, I return false. If I got accept symbol, I return true. Okay, so we got true or false if the pattern is correct. But we need object, oh, type. So we need to build type from string. This is the table from with grammar, but there are few new symbols, the yellow one, which is called semantic actions. Whenever I hit in the semantic action on stack, I'm not doing any parsing or something. I'm modifying subject of my parser somehow. So I need to somehow tag the types. I'm using inheritance to it because I need to decide if it's non-terminal or semantic action. So we need to modify the parser somehow. Function parse takes two arguments now, not just stack, but also subject, which is any type I want. Just third template argument. I look on the top of the stack and decide what to do. If it's semantic action, with some concept or type traits, doesn't matter. I look on previous char, not current one. And I call modify function with current symbol from the stack, which is some action what I should do. Previous symbol or previous input and current subject. I decal type it, instantiate it, get it as object, and call parse function again. Other rest of the function is similar. I decide what to do with ordinary symbols, and call move function with the subject too. The subject just go through move function. So if I'm pushing something, I just move the subject through. If I'm popping input, I move it through it. Same for rejecting or accepting. I'm just returning pair if I'm correct and what I built. Same here. And at the end, we called we look on the output variable, which contains the pair, and look if it's correct and. Also, we have type from our parser, which is type built by the parser itself. So the AST looks like this. If we have something better, for example, A or B, the S on the top is start symbol. It's start symbol. And each symbol which is directly from it was pushed by a rule based from non-terminal S. And the colorful squares on the bottom are semantic action. You can see on this diagram that they behave like postfix notation. So I push A to some stack, B to some stack, and then push operation alternation, which takes two arguments and build the alternation, so I somehow can build the type alternation of char A or char B. And you can do whatever you want with LL grammar. You can build mathematical expression. You can parse C++ theoretically. Do it if you want. Okay, but you need to look on the modify function. modify function looks like this. First is this semantic action from the stack, so its type. So if I get PCRE underscore char, I need to build char on the subject stack. This is the second stack for the parser. One is from input and one is for output. So I will take input, look on the subject stack, and push the char on the top of the stack. Same if I am taking sequence. I will look on the top two symbols from the input and tie them together with concatenation and return on the stack. If I'm pushing a sequence which is longer than just two char, I need to look on top symbol and concatenation and modify it into one concatenation. I'm pushing the symbol B at the end of the concatenation because as I'm parsing, it's otherwise. If it's alternation, it's same. I will take two symbols from the input and I return alternation of two symbols and I'm done. Same for multiple alternations. Optional, it will take one symbol, wrap it into optional. Same thing for plus cycle or star cycle. So we have AST. For the A or B, we got alternation of char A or B. So if you copy this code into the library, it should work. Yeah. Okay. Now we have type representing the regular expression, and we need to match it somehow. And we need to use finite automatons. Finite automatons is mathematical construct, computer science parser, which takes only L, the weakest grammars, regular grammars. And you have multiple states and transition between them. I let this sink in because we are going to second part of the talk. Okay, finite automaton is a five-tuple formula of finite set of states, finite set of input symbols, the alphabet, transition function between state and alphabet into a set of states or state base if the automaton is deterministic or non-deterministic, and start state, which state you are starting in, and set of final states. And if at least if you are non-deterministic and at least one of your current states are accepting, you are accepting at the end. If not, you are not accepting. Yeah. We have example, finite automaton which takes 0 to 9 plus. So we can try it. Number 1 to 3, it accepts. It doesn't accept A or B. It doesn't accept empty string. But if you want to accept negative numbers, you need to modify it somehow. We need to add another transition and another state. So if I'm in minus, it doesn't accept because I'm not in accepting state. Now I am. And if you want to accept decimal numbers, you need to add another transition. Noted, there are multiple accepting states for integrals and for decimals. If you want to accept scientific notation, it doesn't work, obviously, so you need to modify it. And now it's accepting it. So you can see there is a mapping between, I will get to it. Okay, how do you convert the regular expression into finite automaton? You can have a finite automaton which doesn't take anything, not empty state, not any input, nothing. You can have automaton which take only empty input, nothing else. Or you can have automaton which take only one char. And I think you know where I'm going though. You can have also optional, which is empty or A. You can have optional with epsilon transition, which is special one. And if you enter to a state which contains epsilon transition from it, you are immediately going also to another state too. This is non-deterministic automaton. So this one takes empty input or A. You if you have two automatons, one is taking A, one is taking B, and you want to do alternation, you can connect them with epsilon transitions. So at the beginning, I'm in three states at once, but with A, I'm accepting, with B, I'm accepting. So this is operation how to connect two automatons together and build A or B. Oh, sorry. Okay, we have two automatons and we want to do concatenation. We connect ending state of left one to start state of the right one with epsilon state. I'm not connecting them together because there are some cases which doesn't work. So you need to use epsilon transition. In this case, A, B, nothing else. And you can do repetition with epsilon states. So it's A, B, A, B, A, B, A, B. Okay, but epsilon states, epsilon transition are hard to implement. So you can remove them. There is an algorithm for that. Usually it's just connect the states and it's working, usually. It's same automaton which takes same input, but it's much easier to do matching with it. Okay, so we know there is the direct mapping between operation over finite automatons and definition of regular expression as we know it. So we need to map it into C++. We have finite state of states. Let's use it set. Our alphabet will be char 32 because we like Unicode, but it's not enough, but don't tell Peter. Transition function is actually set of tuples from state to state for special char. I don't care about deterministic in this case because difference between non-deterministic and deterministic is if there is a collision or not. So. Start state will be always state zero to make it easier. And accepting state is set of numbers, states, which we're accepting. Do you have any question about it? Okay. You don't need this set of states. Because it's exactly, I have implicit set because the tuple is creating the set. If there is a set which is not available to me, I don't care. So the automaton contains set if you walk the tuple or the set of the tuples, and you can find all accessible states. So it's implicit. Set. There is an easy implementation of set. You have iterators, you have size, you have access operator, you have insert, erase, and you have context per constructor. Any problem with it? Allocation. Sorry? Allocation. Allocation. We are in context per world and we cannot allocate yet. So we need to use fixed set. So you need to tell me how big the set of state or set of transition can be. And actually, you can implement it and you can grow a set later during compilation because it's context per. And yes, you can. OK. transition looks like its tuple. It's struct of source, target, char. I have match function because actually my transition are a little bit complex because I'm using ranges of char, so I can do A to Z, not on IBM machines. Anyway, and some constructors which hides the complexity behind it. And finite automaton is template which takes two arguments, size of transition and size of final state. There is a fixed set of transition and fixed set of final state. Okay, basic building blocks for me are empty finite automaton, which doesn't accept anything, doesn't contain any transition, doesn't contain any final state. Epsilon, which is final automaton, which takes only empty input. So I need one empty state. So I have epsilon. And I have finite automatons for chars, which is template inline variable. So if I want to have finite automaton for char, let's say A, I instantiate one char A, and I have one transition and one accept state. So we need to concatenate two finite automatons. We have two automatons, 0, 1, A, B, C, and X, Epsilon, Z. And we need to concatenate them. We need to add a prefix on the right one. So we look on the maximum value, maximum state from the left one, and add a number plus one to the right one. So it's suddenly 3, 4, 5 on the right. And if we want 10, we remove start from the right one and final states from the left one. And then we connect them with epsilon state, epsilon transition, sorry. In this case, this example shows you why cannot you just join the states, because sometimes it doesn't work. In this case, if I join states 2 and 3, I could have CX, CX, CX on input, which is not the grammar I wanted to accept. So in this case, epsilon state is replaced, can be replaced by all outgoing transitions from the right state. So I will there are two, X and epsilon, so I will copy them. And this is proper removing of epsilon's transition. And this automaton is accepting A, B, C, X, epsilon, Z. Okay, this is implementation in C++. You take finite automaton as a template argument. In C++ 20 you can, because it's literal type. There is no allocation. And another automaton. You calculate size of needed transitions, how many we will need them. You calculate start transition, which is transition from the start node, start state of the right one. You calculate the prefix. You prepare a proper sized output finite automaton type. You copy all left transition from the left one. And for each final state on the left one, you copy all start transitions from the right one and add them into output. And also, you copy all the right one transition with prefix and mark all right one final states with prefix as the final states of the output. And return new final automaton. There is a inline variable which stores the output, and there is a nice inline global variable concat which do that thing for you. So you just call concat with two automatons and you are done. There are other algorithms like alternation, repetition, and these algorithms works exactly the same. You just pre-calculate the space needed, fill it, and you are done. And it looks like this. You have contacts per automaton FA, which concatenate A and B. And you have automaton takes A and B. I call this compile time functions, because these are true compile time arguments. Unlike context per function, this argument keeps their context expressibility. You can change type, actually template, as we had a discussion, based on the argument. And also it makes, because I'm using static inline variable, I'm making sure the compiler will cache the output. For example, GCC is not caching, is caching, and Clang is not caching for some performance reasons, but in my case, it's helpful. There is an algorithm for determinization. Because in some cases, if you, for example, alternate two automaton which takes ABC or AAA, with first A, you don't know where you are going. In this case, I have automaton, and if I push char A here and here, it will go suddenly to two states. The automaton is non-deterministic. And if I want to make it deterministic, I need to join these two states into new one. So I introduce state 0,1, which is copy of two states. And in this case, if I try to insert char B, I am again in another two states. So I need to introduce another state. And finally, my automaton is final is deterministic. Oh, sorry. Determinization can give you two power n states in worst case scenario. And you can see all the, how many you will get if you are doing iteratively. So you need to build one step, check if it's automaton deterministic. If not, do another step. And you are copying type and type, so you're instantiating a lot of types. And it can explode. It's a slow algorithm. And yeah, context per implementation must be iterative, because I cannot allocate final number, because I don't know it. Actually, I can allocate the 2 power of n, but it will eat your memory pretty quickly. So also, after you do the determinization, I'm not showing the algorithm. It's in the library. It's recommended to do minimization of the algorithm, of the automaton. So the automaton is small. OK, we have automaton. But there is no thing as zero-cost abstraction, as Chandler Korut said, and he's going to talk about it on CppCon in 2 weeks. Because everything you do in ConstExpr counts. ConstExpr C++ is actually not compiled language, but interpreted language. And it's slow. It's there are some problems. Every operation counts. There are some limits. So if you have a long loop, GCC can give you error. This loop is too many iteration. It's probably infinite loop. I'm giving up. Clang has a different limit. Clang counts every operation. And I think there is a limit of 1 million or something. And then gives you error. I'm out of the limit. Sorry, your function is not ConstExpr. Move semantics doesn't matter, because if I'm returning automaton from the function, I need to do copy of the automaton, which means number of copy operation for each element of the set. So bigger automaton I'm returning, because I'm doing copy. I cannot move anything. And copy costs me operations. Also, you cannot easily do error handling or debugging. There are a few approaches. You can use conditional UB, because in ConstExpr context, you cannot have UB. Which means if you run into UB, you will get error. And you can use it for some sort of asserts in your code. And also, you can have print style debugging. You have template without any definition. And if you try to instantiate it, you will get exact type you are using it. So you can deduce with meditation what happened. OK. And there is the context pair problem. It's really slow and painfully slow. The NFA determination took 2 minutes for big regular expression on GCC. It took 40 seconds on Clang 8. But nothing is that bad as it seems. It takes less than 5 seconds in PHP. Okay, and we need to match the regular expression, the automaton. So I'm going to show how to do matching, and hopefully we will be on time. Tell two function match and search, which takes the pattern, which is translated into the finite automaton, and takes the argument and return bool. Fast match function check if the pattern is correct. Then build the type. In my case, it's DAST as a types. And then takes the AST, build non-deterministic automaton from it, build a deterministic automaton, and then it minimizes it. And suddenly I have automaton, which I can use for the FA matching, which takes a pair of iterators from the range. For it, I need some helpers, like, there is a function, there are some helpers. The NFA from function takes, it calls another function build, which takes empty automaton, which is automaton which doesn't take accept anything, and the AST on the right. And it iteratively built the automaton from the AST. Yeah, it takes the AST in the stack, it takes the empty automaton, and yeah, it calls build, and it builds the NFA. The build function looks like this. If the stack is empty, so I'm finished, I just return the automaton I got. If the if there is an epsilon somehow on the stack, I just concatenate current automaton with epsilon, which I don't need to, but why not? And I need to, actually. I need to accept. I need to accept empty input. And concatenate them, remove the epsilon from the stack, and call itself again recursively. Char, it's same. If there is a char on the stack, I concatenate the automaton with the helper char automaton for the current one char, and build it, remove char from stack, and called myself again. Concatenation sequence is same. I have concat of something, so I just remove the concat and call myself again. Each one, and so on. And takes the automaton on the left, and stack, and continue. Alternation is similar. But I will look only all options, and I build alternative, which is like A or B or C or D, with fault expression. I will build it. And then I concatenate it with the left automaton, and I'm done. And again, call myself recursively again. Star, which is cycle, I just built the star contains something, the content. So I take this and build the star for the, I will build the internal automaton, wrap it into star, and concatenate it with the left automaton. And I'm done. I'm calling myself again. So after I apply this function recursively on the whole stack, I got the finite automaton as the value. and I need to match it. There's a function fast match, which takes the automaton, determinize it, minimize it, and called function match state. Match state takes the automaton as the template argument. Default state is zero because it's starting state, and it takes two iterators, current one and end. And if current state is final, and I'm at the end of the input, I can return true. Otherwise, if I am at the end, I return false. So I look on the first transition for my state, because the transition are sorted by sort state. And I called function choose transition. Function choose transition takes the automaton, index of current transition, current state, iterators, and look, it check if the transition is out of boundaries. If it's, I run out of them. Or if I'm checking for different state than I was supposed to, because I'm doing it linearly, I return false. But if I'm my current transition is for my state, I can check it against current iterator, and if it does match, I call match state for next target state. I jump to another state. If I'm not, I try next transition in the sequence. So notice all the returns and calls at the end are tail recursion. So you actually don't need stack to calculate it. And so you will have on, and at the end, return false, yeah. So the time complexity of matching of the with DFA is linear with length of input and average number of transition per state. But you don't need any memory. If it's constant memory, you don't need anything. And compiler will help you. But it doesn't support capture tracking, but it's theoretically the quickest approach how to parse regular expressions. It allows you work on stream data. If you have stream data, you can just remember state and jump. If you get few terabytes of memory, you are okay. Okay, there are different algorithms, NFA backtracking and NFA bitwalk backtracking. I'm using in CTRE also a backtracking mechanism, because it supports capture tracking, back references, and so on and so on. And I'm currently working on NFA without backtracking. Okay, some assembly. We have a few minutes. This is standard regular expression for the regular expression Aloha or A to Z star. And it's a lot. 13,000 lines of assembly for such a regular expression. And the regular expression is known at compile time for the compiler, so probably it should be optimized. And this is assembly for CTR boost, which is similar. It's a little smaller, only 6,000 lines of assembly. But same pattern, it's doing exactly the same thing. I don't know.
It looks like it.
That's some grammar, there are some. It's crazy.
It's big.
Yeah. And this is grammar for generated by fast matching for CTRE. 17 lines of assembly. And it's doing exactly the same thing. You can see that A is 97, and length of alphabet is 25. You can actually read the assembly. And notice there is no Aloha in as part of the regular expression, because Aloha is subset of A to Z. And during determinization and minimization, it's optimized away. OK, benchmarks. I did grep-like scenario on my MacBook, which is searching, which is dot star something dot star. I did median of the measurement, and I used GCC 9.1 and Clang 8. These are standard. What happened? Wait a sec. Yeah, this is better. Standard library. I'm measuring throughput, 21 megabytes per second in Clang, libc++. EGRAP on same computer, 102 megabytes per second. If you look on JavaScript core, on Node.js, it's much quicker, which is sad. If you look on standard expressive library, boost library, RE2 from Google. RE2 from Google is nice and quick. It's using DFA and NFA matching. And PCRE, 500 megabytes per second. OK. PCRE with jitting gives you 2 gigabytes. But they are doing crazy magic, and you cannot use it in the embed world because you cannot generate code in runtime. OK, I removed JavaScript and grep. CTRE with backtracking gives you 600 megabytes, almost 700 megabytes per second for the button on the top for Clang. And CTRE with DFA gives you 2 gigabytes per second on Clang without jitting. And actually, I didn't do any optimization at all. I'm just using the straightforward approach I showed you in slide. OK, with GCC, it's a little different. GCC was able to optimize even backtracking mechanism somehow for this pattern, which is nice. And if I change the pattern to be much more backtracking heavy, you can see that the engines, it's a little mix up. You can see, like, it's always like you need to think about your regular expression as a programming language. You program, and you need to optimize your regular expression. You cannot just write something which works. OK, with Clang, same pattern, it's similar. PCRE with jitting always wins somehow, I don't know. OK, for your info, measured code looks like this. I include all the libraries headers, so it's fair, because I'm measuring actually the compilation, not the parsing. I prepare pattern for the library. I load file line by line into memory. I do some warm up. And then I measure only searching of sync views of the each line. And at the end, I will print number of match lines and time needed to match. Compilation on Clang, which it doesn't do anything, just read the, all the libraries, take 3 seconds and something. Standard library takes 5.2 seconds. So difference is the compilation. CTRE with backtracking take 3.3 seconds. And CTRE deterministic automaton takes 6.6 seconds because there is a lot of work doing determinization. PCRE, it's cost virtually nothing because it's C library, it's just call. RE2 is from Google and it's quick, but it's also actually just a call to library. And PCRE JIT, in error margin, a little, but. And there is a boost library, which is much worse than when I'm doing the magic with DFA, and they are just calling functions and templates, but boost. If I remove the baseline and look only on compilation, it's you can see the difference between parsing and compilation. Sometimes the DFA matching costs you, but the performance is awesome. So, and I'm working on making it better. Okay, with GCC, it's bad because GCC context per engine is slower than Clang's. Okay, 5 things I showed you. How regular expression engines works, what is the connection between theory and code, because you need to know theory when you are going to write code. How parsing, how can you do the parsing in compilation? How can you build finite automaton? And I do comparison between regular expression implementation. And you should remember 4 things. Compiler will optimize your code if you help him. Or it, or whatever. you can combine TMP and context pair function nicely, and it helps you express things more clearly. It's like writing in typeless language, which sometimes helps. And you should stop pretending that context pair C++ is compiled language. Every operation counts. And try the CTRU libraries. It's not just for speed, but it's also code clarity. It's really easy to use if you want to check arguments of your binary. It gives you just a few lines of assembly. It's cheap. Thank you. You can find the code there. Any question? 2 minutes, and then you need to find me. Because that will be the next talk. OK?
You said there are limitations to the number of operations you can do at time.
Yeah, that is there.
How does that translate into when you use the RAID? How long RAID do you have?
It depends. If you do backtracking, if you like, my personal limit for sane regular expression is like 50 chars. If you do something bigger, you should think about life choices.
50 or 50?
50. Or something like. If your regular expression is longer than the line of your editor, it's something bad. Because you should do it just matching. If you do something bigger, it's just it's some different programming, and you can do better in C++. But I'm currently working on a better parser for the patterns and engine, and there will be actually no limit at all, theoretically. So you will be able to parse few kilobytes of regular expression, and it will be okay. Okay, next question. There was another one. No one?
Did you ever consider making instead of writing this thing yourself?
Mm-hmm.
Did you ever consider writing that in a different language and then writing a transpiler into?
Yeah.
Question
was if I ever try to write a transpiler from regular expression to some code and use it. I originally wanted to, generate LLVM bytecode and then run it in my application, but it's still just a runtime regular expression. This is just based on the properties of C++ language, and it is working. Similar thing is in D. There are compile time regular expressions too, and in Rust. I wanted to for C++, and hopefully it will get into some future standard somehow. That's it.
Would it be able to integrate as or even serve as an implementation alternative in the standard? Because the interface is very similar.
Yeah, we cannot touch standard regular expression API.
But the API was the same, wasn't it?
It's same, but we cannot touch it because we will break ABI. And
okay.
So we can build a new one and silently forget about old one.
Sure.
Okay, thank you. If you want, later.